Hi everyone. Good to see you all. So, welcome to this biweekly teaching, and we will do the same format as usual, as you know it. And Andrew will talk around about an hour, and then he will take question. So if you have question, please move your mouth and you will see at the bottom of the Zoom window the chat, and then you can write down your question. And then I will read the question to Andrew and he will answer to you, and I will open your mic. And one last thing, if you can, it will be wonderful if you can activate your camera. So it will make a more human atmosphere, and Andrew can see who he is talking to. Thank you so much. And from that, I'm happy to hand over to you, Andrew. Is it working now, maybe, Andrew? Yeah, you're
Now it's
good.
here. Hi, everybody. Nice to see you. So I wanted to speak about a little bit about the whole notion of destiny, which I find a very intriguing idea and truth about reality. And also there's the question of whether whether there's such a thing as predestiny or not, whether your future is already predetermined, or whether the way reality unfolds is more complicated than that. I wanted to explore some of these thoughts. And for me, a lot of these are really open questions more than anything else, but I often think about this whole notion of destiny and predestiny, and whether destiny, to repeat what I just said, is predetermined in some kind of mysterious way or not. Many of the greatest realizers felt that destiny was preordained already. Like Ramana Maharshi and Sri Aurobindo felt that reality was, in a sense, the context of reality was already in relation to time and history, time, past, present, and future, was kind of already enfolded. And that the unfolding of history was the unfolding of that which had been enfolded. So that's a notion of reality and time and past, present, and future that speaks of the notion of predetermination. It's already set in stone. And I think reality works in a way that's much more complicated than that and much more interesting, I believe. But before I go into that, I wanted to say that as I've been thinking about this talk for a few days, I realized that the awakening of consciousness, excuse me, the awakening to consciousness, the awakening to enlightenment, which is the basic subject of my Dharma, the understanding of enlightenment, the pursuit of its subtlety and mystery, that in the context of the awakening to enlightened awareness, inherent in the context of the thought of destiny is always something, always the presence of a mysterious constant that is indescribably positive or absolutely positive, overwhelmingly positive, gloriously positive. And I've noticed that whenever I think over the years, and I might have found myself thinking about time in the context of enlightenment, it always promises a outcome, a point of arrival, of landing in a place, in a space, in a destination, in a karmic context that is utterly glorious and beautiful and wonderful and absolutely life-affirming and good. And then in contrast to that, the ego, or the unenlightened ego, the unenlightened frontal self, can often have notions about destiny and the future that are less than glorious, and often, not always, but often, pregnant with doubt and fear about the outcome, about future outcomes, and thoughts of different kinds of doom and gloom and less than purely positive outcomes. I've been reflecting on that a lot over the last few weeks. And I would encourage a lot of you to pay attention in your own experience to how this works, and to see how when you are awakened to the light of your own enlightened awareness, when you are in a state of enlightenment, or the closest that you ever get to it, when your ego temporarily disappears from the stage, it's kind of miraculous and very interesting that the future suddenly begins to look a lot brighter. And that seems to be part, it seems to be part and parcel of the state of consciousness that is enlightenment, is the presence of this. It's not optimism. It's not merely optimism. It's not merely a good feeling. It has to do with some kind of fundamental organic orientation in relationship to the totality of reality that is pointing towards heaven, or what Tara Dushanet called the omega point. Kind of speaks to some, it speaks when it, when that means when thinking about the future, you start to see a bright light. And that bright light is the vibration of an eternal brilliance, brightness, goodness, glory, immensity. And it seems to be a staple, or a foundational organic element, metaphysical element that's part and parcel of the metaphysical vision of enlightenment. So it's very significant. And remember, in some of the more traditional Eastern ideas about enlightenment, there's always a point of arrival. The destination is the yonder shore. The Buddha always spoke about the yonder shore. So he also spoke about landing on the beach, landing on the beach in heaven. And to go along with that idea, just for our speculative, metaphysical, imaginal exploration here, if you can imagine that if you arrived in heaven, if you arrived in heaven and you arrived on the beach, the beach was in heaven, it wouldn't be an ordinary beach. I can't imagine exactly what it would look like, but I'm sure it would be magnificent and glorious and infinitely more gorgeous than the beaches in Thailand or Brazil. So, just to repeat all this once again, in the context of the awakening to enlightened awareness, in this case, the awakening to enlightened awareness is the lens through which we're perceiving reality, perceiving our experience of reality and interpreting it. In the context of the awakening to enlightened awareness, our destiny means our landing point in the future, in the distant future, if it's going to be distant, always looks heavenly. It always looks marvelous and beautiful. And whereas, in contrast to the unenlightened ego, the future doesn't always look so glorious. It might look good. You're a lucky person with good karma. But our destiny does not look enchanted with inconceivable and overwhelming positivity and miraculous brightness. So these are just some things to kind of consider as you observe yourself traveling through your own consciousness experience and traversing different states of consciousness. See how reality looks, especially in relation to time, past, present, and future. Because that's what this whole notion of destiny has to do with. And as I'm just to think out loud, I'm thinking that one of the attributes of the awakening to enlightened awareness is the doubtlessness about the ultimate nature of the real, the ultimate nature of reality. And it's inherent and unavoidable, indescribable positivity. And obviously, if you're in touch with that consciousness and that way of seeing reality as a direct experience, it means your relationship to time, past, present, and future, and making choices is going to be very different than if it's otherwise. These are just some things to pay attention to in your experience as time goes by. So, karma, dharma, destiny, and free will. So, the human experience occurs in a karmic context. Your experience, my experience, our experience occurs in a karmic context. Your experience does not occur in a static context, but a context that's moving and changing all the time. So your personal karmic context appears in, within a vast sea of shifting sands. There's the momentum of cosmic evolution, the momentum of cultural evolution, the momentum of biological evolution. There's your own personal, emotional, psychological processes. So there's many different currents of there's many different currents and many different contexts that are unfolding all around us and within us and through us all the time. And they all have momentum. They're all moving. So that's what I mean by karma. So you, whoever you are, we seem to be some kind of static entity observing and experiencing these different currents of momentum from cosmic to psychological all the time. Sometimes we're more aware of some currents than others. But just to repeat the image, just to get a sense of what karma is all about, you want to understand that all of these currents are moving through you, within you and around you all the time, all of us. So the semblance or the appearance of a static self that's observing and feeling all these currents and moving through all these currents is observing and experiencing this momentum. Now, the great biologist Rupert Sheldrake came up with a beautiful way to describe this karmic momentum. He called them cosmic habits. The karmic momentum is created by habits or repeated behaviors. If you enact a certain behavior and keep repeating it, it starts developing its own momentum. This can happen at a cosmic level in terms of the material cosmos, in terms of planets and stars, and can happen at the level of biological life and our inner subjective emotional and psychological experience, all these different levels. There's karmic habits at all in all these different levels of existence, of our own existence. And all of these karmic habits are creating their own momentum. And just to continue to develop this theme, we find ourselves appearing to be static entities observing these momentum, the momentum of these cosmic habits moving through us. And a lot of the time we feel helpless to do anything about the situation, except to feel overwhelmed by the current, by all of these currents washing over us and through us all at once. And at other times, when we're very strong and clear and full of spiritual power, we feel a great capacity to control our relationship to the movement of these kind of momentum through us and around us. Now, the whole point of Dharma, the whole point of Dharma is to reveal to us practices and ways of understanding reality that can help us to no longer be completely and utterly victimized and overwhelmed by these currents, these karmic currents, the currents of karma. But the awakening to and the practice of the Dharma will enable us to gain a measure of control over how we're navigating, how we're engaging with these different levels of momentum. It's almost as if, you're in a ship on the surface of a very wild ocean. You didn't have any rudder, you didn't have any oars, you didn't have any engine. So the boat would be tossed in any direction. It had no power to steer itself or guide itself. Versus if you If you had a boat with a strong rudder and a strong steering wheel and a strong sail, strong motion, strong engine, you suddenly have a great capacity now to guide yourself through the storm and to point yourself in whatever direction you felt was most important to go, was most beneficial. So the karma, we want to understand karma as being this, the momentum of these vast currents of momentum. And the Dharma is a way that we can gain a measure of control over the direction we're going in through the kinds of choices that we make and the relationship we have to our thoughts and our actions. If we don't understand the Dharma, if we have no awakening to the Dharma, to these universal spiritual laws, it's very hard to know how to guide our ship, and to even know that's ultimately possible to do so. And then there's the issue of free will. So I know there's a lot of debate over whether human beings have free will or not. And I ultimately don't know the answer to the question, but I do believe that we all have a measure of free will. I don't think we have much. I don't think we have much free will, but I think we all have been given a measure of free will. We all have a little bit. And the reason I said that is because the more we learn about the human experience, the more we learn about human biology and human psychology and neuroscience, it seems that we're infinitely more conditioned, programmed on multiple levels all at the same time. We're infinitely more programmed and conditioned than we ever had any idea about before. So the more we find out about the human condition, the more we find out that we're more conditioned than we ever even realize. And the more we're conditioned, the less freedom of choice we actually seem to have, because we're all so much, so many of our experiences and the way we respond to them are pre-programmed at unconscious levels. But in spite of all that, the good news is I think we're all born with a measure of freedom to choose. We're born with a measure of freedom. A measure doesn't mean a big measure, but a small measure. But a measure of freedom is infinitely better than no freedom at all. So, as many of you have heard me say before, I think a big part of spiritual practice is developing the muscle, just the developing the muscle, the strength, the capacity to learn how to become a more conscious person. And the more conscious we become, the more we gain the ability to make more conscious choices. And through making more conscious choices, we express more and more free will and become more and more self-determined, conscious human beings instead of unconscious, blind robots. And a lot of times I feel that most of us, in too many ways, more often than not, are actually unconscious blind robots rather than conscious, self-directed, deeply sensitive, aware human beings. So much of our behavior is unconscious and thoughtless. So in this way, we understand, to repeat, that spiritual practice is about to learn how to develop this muscle of the capacity to make choices, to make conscious choices. And we say that the more spiritually evolved we are, the more powerful we become as human beings in the expressing of our capacity to make conscious choices, choices that come from a place of inner freedom. And then, therefore, the more we cultivate this muscle and this capacity to choose, to make conscious, informed choices, deeply consciously informed choices, then we get into, then we find ourselves in a position where we can be able to begin to determine our destiny. We get ourselves in a position where we are able to begin to determine our destiny. And that's the most exciting part of all this, because an unconscious person, an unenlightened person, a deeply conditioned, unconscious robot kind of person, seems to be so conditioned and so unconscious of all the ways they're conditioned, they seem to have no capacity to determine their destiny from any from a place of any kind of inner freedom, which is the destiny of most human beings. Whereas the possible, whereas when we pursue this higher development, this possibility of higher development in our own higher development, we begin to discover, especially in our moments of enlightenment, moment, our most enlightened moments, that it actually becomes possible to deeply determine our destiny, our destination, our destiny, the outcome of this human birth, which I think is very exciting. So if you're a victim, if you see yourself as being a victim, you can't make enlightened choices that are going to be able to determine your destiny in any kind of positive or deeply constructive way. So when you think about what it means to become an architect of your own destiny, coming from the deepest and highest part of yourself, living the spiritual life in earnest and practicing the Dharma and defeating the laws of karma, begins to become very exciting as a possibility and very empowering, even just to begin to think about it. Because most people don't realize that we have these latent powers to create our own destiny, to create our own futures, to determine our destiny, determine our own futures. But when you begin to wake up to the Dharma and you begin to actually experience the truth of this, it's very spiritually empowering. It's enormously spiritually empowering. So I believe very much that the forces of karma, the overwhelming momentum of these cosmic habits at all these different levels of our being, from biological to cultural to psychological, metaphysical, that the momentum of karma is real. We're all born from and into a sea of momentum, swirling all around us, carrying us forward, for better and for worse. It's not all good news. Some of that momentum is bad news, and some of it's good news. It's all mixed up. And a big part of practicing the spiritual life in earnest is trying to sort all this out and make sense of it, clarify it to ourselves, and start making conscious choices, and so we can begin to liberate ourselves from all the chaos and all the confusion. So karma is real. The momentum of karma is very real. And to liberate ourselves, we have to do battle with that momentum. We have to put our hands on the steering wheel of our own boat, our own body, mind, personality, and take control of the ship with all of our spiritual energy, but with all of the spiritual energy that we can bring to the task, and purify our mind, purify our thought process, clarify our thought process, liberate our thought process, so we can point the ship in the right direction. Because will karma determine your destiny? Will karma determine our destiny, my destiny? Or will freedom of choice or agency determine our destiny, your destiny, or my destiny? It's a big and important question. If we're not very careful, most people aren't that careful, but if we're not very careful, it will be karma that will determine our destiny and not freedom of choice, not liberated agency. The nature of karma is such that it's the power of its influence and control over our actions and thoughts and reactions is much more profound and powerful than most of us dare to believe. The whole A big part of why this is so difficult to do is because it's almost impossible to see how unconscious we are. It's almost impossible to see it. We can have brief moments of deep, deep insight when we can glimpse it for a moment, especially in other people. What, who, me? Not me. Bringing the light of enlightened awareness and bringing the awakened vision of liberation, the possibility of liberation of that yonder shore to the picture here, begins to change everything. Well, yeah. But just to finish this last thought, to repeat. If we're not willing to make the noble effort to liberate ourselves, our karma, the momentum of the vast momentum of karma on so many different levels, will for sure determine our destiny, not our measure of freedom to choose. And as I said before, that's usually what happens. And oh yeah, because what I was saying was that it's very difficult to see how unconscious we are ourselves. It's almost impossible to see it because we're so lost in a world of appearances. Lost in a world of appearances of the way things seem to be. Like I said, when you wake up, you begin to see through the illusion of so many ideas, thoughts, beliefs, imaginings that make up human consciousness and cognition. But when you begin to see through it, you realize that you're seeing through layers and layers and layers of something like a multiverse of different perspectives. So this is a really big deal to wake up and to stay awake and to keep working on it. Keep working on staying awake and becoming conscious. Because as I said, it's impossible for us to see how unconscious we really, really, really are. We can understand it intellectually, but to actually see it ourselves with our own eyes and our own hearts, it's very hard. So much of what we think and so many of our private thoughts are projections from our own subconscious mind, unconscious mind, and conscious mind. And so many of these projections are being carried along on this momentum of karma. In light of everything I'm trying to share with you, you can see why learning how to be very still, 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 and learning how to really pay attention and let go in all the ways that I teach when I teach meditation, for example. And then you can begin to appreciate how important it is to learn how to really do that as deeply and as powerfully as possible. Because in a sense, our destiny and our capacity to potentially shape our own destiny depends on it, it would seem. Because as you know, in this teaching, I basically say there's two, if we want to become an aware, if we want to awaken to enlightened awareness and become a liberated soul, a liberated human being, we have to become good at two spiritual acts. One is letting go. The other is making the right choices. Which means, in other words, having no relationship is letting go. And having the right relationship is making the right choices. And learning how to do both of those things very well. So it determines our destiny and our spiritual enlightenment or lack of it. So one of the things I wanted to emphasize in this talk, which I have been, just to repeat, is the overwhelming force of karma. Its momentum is tremendous, and it's everywhere. It's everywhere. We're swimming in a sea of momentum of karma. So it's good to never underestimate it. Because as I said before, it's very difficult to see all this because we don't see very much of what's actually there. So it's good to help to humble ourselves to realize that the force of karma is real, it's profound, it's powerful. Doesn't mean it can't be defeated. Doesn't mean we can't be victorious and liberated in spite of it and in the face of it. But it means we just want to get a clear sense of the enormity of the task at hand so we can approach the opportunity this life is giving us with the appropriate level of sincerity and total commitment to the possibility of our own liberation. Referring back to what I was saying at the beginning of my talk, I think you can understand why it's important in the process of this practice that we have enough access to enlightened awareness that we can begin to see that this was what's called the omega point, that sparkling bright light that exists in the distant future that's calling us to itself. It's the call of perfection, total liberation, and unimaginable beauty. It's important that we have access to the omega point as an inner vision, that you can see it, that you can feel it pulling you towards itself. Because you can see if we're going to be able to withstand the currents of karma without drowning in them, having the vision of this omega point pulling us forward is almost essential, not to get lost, not to lose our way. That's why I often say that believing in enlightenment is, if you believe that enlightenment is real, or that this absolute principle is real, or this God principle is real, then you've already won half the battle. Because that means you know there's a way out. And when the omega point appears before your inner eye, as the sparkling light of perfect purity and perfect liberation that always exists in the distant future, that you can feel it, call it, when you can feel it calling you to itself, when you feel its vibration and it's tugging at your heart, pulling you towards itself, that becomes you, that becomes the focus of your inner vision, which is on this infinite destination in the infinite future. And as long as you keep your eye locked on that target, you won't get lost in samsara, because you'll have your eye on the omega point. You won't have your eye on anything. You won't be focused on what's happening here. You'll be focused on where you're going and how you're going to get there. If you don't have that, if you're not aware of the vibration and pulsation of the omega point, it's very easy to get lost in samsara, lost in the illusion of how things appear in the context of relativity, materiality, and duality. I think when your spiritual development ripens or gets stable, becomes stable, this vision of the omega point, this vision of this bright light that's from the future that's calling you, becomes a constant. It's constantly available to you. So karma is real and overwhelming in its being everywhere. Dharma is the way out. Dharma is how we save ourselves. The Dharma are spiritual laws, metaphysical laws and truths that inform us on how we can liberate ourselves. Our destiny, your destiny and my destiny and our destiny, is not predetermined. That's the good news. Even if it seems like it's predetermined, it's not necessarily the case for all the reasons that I've been describing. When the ego gets very strong, when the negative ego gets very strong, and you are one, begin to feel very weak. We feel very weak. We can feel compelled to want to give up. It's too hard for me. I can't do this. And that's when the ego creates this appearance that your destiny is predetermined, and so predetermined there's nothing you can do to change it. And it's very interesting that when we feel weak, when the ego gets strong and we feel weak, that's how things seem. Versus when you feel strong, when you feel spiritually empowered, you feel the thrill of the possible, the thrill of self-transformation, the thrill of self-liberation, the thrill of the call of evolution. Is the thrill of the awareness of infinite potential. And that's powerful. Makes you feel strong. And that's when you begin to feel like you're co-creating this whole process. And that you actually have enough power to be a co-creator. And that's when you realize that destiny is not yet to be determined. And that in the end, You're choosing to be the one who's going to determine what the outcome is. And for the practice of yoga, I mean, that's what the practice of yoga is all about. To defeat karma and even be stronger than nature. Be a master of both at some metaphysical level. Let's repeat what I just said. When we feel weak and we feel tempted to give up because it's feel, we feel it's too hard, the momentum of karma is too overwhelming. That's when our thought process begins to tell us that there's nothing we can do and that the outcome is already predetermined, that our destiny is predetermined. There's nothing we can do. We have no choice. We have no power to change anything. We're the perfect victim. And when we feel strong and inspired and awake and turned on, we feel quite the opposite. We feel infinitely powerful and awake to the enormous potential that's present in every moment if we have the eyes to see it. So the more conscious a person we become, the more we have to take responsibility for determining our own destiny. And so, following along these footsteps, ask yourselves right now in the privacy of your own mind, are you determining your own destiny? Does it feel to you like you're determining your own destiny? Or are you a victim of karma, your own karma? Everybody knows the answer to that question, I think, if you're an intelligent self, an intelligent, sensitive person who practices self-reflection. I'm sure you know the answer. Have the courage to look into the reality of your life and the way you're living and ask yourself the question, are you determining your own destiny? Are you determining the outcome? Are you living with a vision of the future that's based upon having your attention focused on the vibration that's coming from the omega point? Is that where you're focused? Or are you focused more on more mundane, mundane things that are more rooted to present reality and present circumstances, and not on the infinite potential that always lies ahead in the next moment and in the future? In the evolutionary vision, what's so inspiring about the evolutionary vision is we always have a vision of the possible. No matter what's happening in the present moment, you're always awake to the possible, what's possible. I can see what's possible. And my attention is on what's possible, not just on what is. It's part of an evolutionary vision, evolutionary orientation to the experience of being human, an awake human being. So think about this whole exciting notion of cultivating the intention to determine your own to consciously determine your own destiny. I find the word destiny very powerful. It's a very profound word. It's, to me, I don't know why, I find it very emotionally compelling and spiritually compelling. But getting back to what I was saying at the beginning of my talk, I was reflecting upon my own experience, and I find it very meaningful that inherent in the awakening to enlightened awareness and state of consciousness that we're calling enlightened awareness, the vibration and pulsation of the presence of eternity, is this pre-conscious, doubtless conviction that destination is glorious beyond imagination. Not because somebody told you that as kind of some kind of Old Testament story or some kind of mythic idea, But I think you'll find if you pay attention to your own inner experience when you're in awakened, when you're in a state of awakened consciousness or enlightened awareness, you'll see that what I'm describing actually is already there. That what we call heaven or nirvana already exists as your destination or my destination or our destiny from the perspective of enlightenment itself. So the fact that this glorious destination already exists inherent in consciousness itself when it's awakened means something profound and miraculous about this the structure of reality. I think so. So if you want to live a glorious, spiritually enlightened, meaningful, purposeful existence, you need to have a vision of that, of the glory of that existence. A living metaphysical vision has to be awakened within you. One that's so strong that it'll be stronger than the momentum of karma, the past karma. The vision of the possible has to become more powerful than the overwhelming influence of karma upon our souls and minds and bodies and personalities. So if karma is real, and it certainly is real, we got to start paying attention to it. And paying attention to the momentum of karma in light of of cultivating our own aspiration to become truly liberated Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. We mustn't let karma determine our destiny. We mustn't let karma determine our destiny. We must not let karma determine our destiny. We need to cultivate the spiritual strength and spiritual will and spiritual inspiration to become stronger than the overwhelming force of karma, momentum of karma all around us, through us, and within us. And if we're determined, we can do it. But then your life has to start looking beautiful, good, powerful. Your life has started looking like that's what you're already doing. Our lives need to look like what we care about the most. I believe that, especially in the context of everything I'm laying out here. So if anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to try and answer them. Do my best under the overwhelming weight of karma that I'm swimming in. I'll try to express a coherent thought. See if I can do it.
So if you have questions, please write down in the chat window.
Karma, Dharma, destiny, and free will.
So we already have two questions, Andrew.
Okay.
So the first one is coming from Sandy. And she's
Okay.
saying, I learn well with examples. Can Andrew share example of his personal experiences with letting go, right decisions, and what it looks like and feels like to experience enlightenment as opposed to living in ego?
Well, I feel on the spot now. Can you read the question again?
So, can Andrew share ex examples of his personal experience with letting go, right decision, and what it looks like and
Hold
feels
on,
like?
hold on, wait
Yeah.
a second. Well, for example, to give this talk tonight, I had to let go to be able to do it. Because I like to kind of have things figured out if I'm going to give a talk, I want to kind of have a clear sense of what I want to speak about. And I don't always feel when I get in a moment of inspiration to give a talk, it's usually about 2 weeks until the actual event happens. But usually when the time's coming to give the talk, and when it comes around, I'm kind of can't remember what I was so excited about I'm on a particular issue anymore. I have to remind myself, what was that? What was I so excited about? And I have to get myself back into and reconnect. And that reconnecting with this inspiration came from about 2 weeks ago, I think, or 10 days ago. So I had to start thinking about the subject again and remembering why I found it so exciting, so intriguing. And then usually what happens is when I do reconnect and remember what I wanted to share, I realize at a certain point I just have to let go of the topic, let go of the plan, let go of the plan, and just trust that the spirit that moves me will take care of business. So it leaves my ego in a little bit of a shaky place, because the ego wants a guarantee. The ego wants a script. I want a clear script. I want it very well punctuated. I want it on clean paper. I want to know where all the sentences begin and end, and I want to guarantee that it's going to be perfect from the very beginning. And even for me, the way that this works is I just have to trust that it's going to be okay. And I'll be able to do it, even if I don't feel as connected as I'd like to. And it usually works. So I have to let go. It's kind of a letting go of wanting to be in control. At least that's just how I operate. I have to let go of the need to be in control. I have to dare to be spontaneous. And usually it works. Usually it works, and usually because I'm able to let go in a very deep way, I often surprise myself. But I surprise myself because I'm not controlling what I'm doing. I'm trusting that I'm going to be able to do it. I'm not feeling totally convinced all the time. And even when I don't feel totally convinced, I trust anyway. And that usually works. That's a big part of my strategy, is comes from trusting. As my guru said to me, he said, Andrew, I'm so glad you found a friend you'll never be able to see. So by trusting that friend I'll never be able to see is how I'm able to do this. And it requires a lot of letting go of the knowing mind. I have to let go of my knowing mind and my own ego, because the ego always knows better. My ego thinks it knows better than my enlightened self. Believe it or not, the ego always knows better than everybody, including mine. But my ego knows better than my authentic self, thinks it knows better. So when you get good at this teaching, you learn how to let these voices speak in your mind and not listen to them. Because you know they're just the voice of your ego, and they're not who you really are, so you don't have to pay any attention to what they're saying. But if you're not spiritually liberated, if you're not spiritually strong, the voice of the ego will intimidate you and it will frighten you. And its momentum can destabilize you. But if you're strong, and you're clear in the Dharma, and you're clear about the difference between the authentic self, the true self, the negative ego and the positive ego, you won't be scared because you'll know what's going on. And even if you get scared, you won't let it scare you. Even if you get scared, you won't let it scare you, because you'll know that it's just coming from your small self. And if there's nothing to worry about. But why? Because it's not real. But you've got to do the doing of this. No one can do it for you. You have to be the one at the steering wheel of that boat that's lost its stormy seas, and you have to be the one that's directing it, and making choices. So that was the first part of the question. What was the next part of the question?
So it was what it looks like and feels like to experience enlightenment as opposed to living in ego.
It feels free, it feels vulnerable, it feels unencumbered, it feels happy, joyful, it feels like unbounded love. It feels like freedom has no history. It's the experience of freedom from history. It's the presence, it's the pregnant presence of infinite potential, the exciting and exhilarating pregnant presence of infinite potential. It feels sane, sacred, sober, and real. Sane, sacred, sober, and real. And keep going, Vincent. What's the next part?
It was the last part.
Okay, very good. This is Sandy?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, hi, Sandy. Okay. Are you satisfied with the answer?
Thank you.
Anything particular struck you about it that you want to pursue, or are you good?
I'm just learning, so all of this is really hard for me to digest. So that's why the examples help me a lot. I like when you share vulnerability and your personal experience with all of these different concepts.
You know, it's the most important thing, Sandy. And it's can you turn up your volume because I can't hear you that well.
Okay, it's up all the way.
That what's more important than having a clear intellectual understanding of what I'm saying is getting the feeling, is getting kind of a feeling of rightness and trueness and depth. Do you feel when I'm speaking that there's a deep coherence, not just from the words, but through the words? I think there's a coherence that I'm trying to express or that I'm expressing. It's more important than the content of the words. Even though what I'm trying to say using the words and the language is important, what will open you up is when you experience this the presence of a deeper feeling of coherence and depth, metaphysical depth, that rings true, that feels right and true and good. It feels right and true. That you feel is trustworthy. That's what can begin to change you. And then, of course, it's very important that the words make sense, that what I'm saying actually has meaning. It's not just gibberish. Because the way we use language is very important, the way spiritual teachers use language is very important. The ways we define our terms is very important. But that's of secondary importance right now. But if you get a feeling of deep coherence and depth, it feels right and true to you. And that feels spiritually affirming and exhilarating and pregnant with potential, then that's a good sign. Okay.
Yeah, I think I have a disconnect. My brain is hearing your words, and I'm busy trying to understand, and I want to feel them, but there seems to be a disconnect where I can't feel it. So I was hoping the examples would help with that.
You know what? Don't worry about it. Are you enjoying spending the time with me?
Yes.
On a scale from 1 to 10, how much are you enjoying it?
Probably about a seven.
All right, so we're doing pretty good. 7's not bad. That's a pretty good grade. So it means it's a positive experience you're having.
For sure.
So if you stick with it, it'll go from 7 to 10. But don't worry, don't let the mind be the determining factor in this kind of context, in this kind of conversation. Because the ego, the small self, doesn't want to have anything to do with the kind of spiritual freedom I'm talking about. So the ego can come up with all kinds of gimmicks as a way to distract your attention from paying attention.
Yeah, I feel that. I feel that.
Very good. But don't so the so that that doubting voice inside, you don't have to worry about it right now. Just let it go. When you start feeling, then it will get up to an 8 pretty quick. Okay, very
Thank
good.
you.
Very good, Sandy. Okay, sure.
And we have a question from Stefan
Okay.
saying, as a matter of choice in destiny or in context of karma, it seems the only choice would be to adhere to the will of God in one's own unique condition.
Yeah, absolutely. Good choice. Good choice.
Yeah, that would actually, God is also the friend you never be able to see.
Exactly right, that's true.
So that feels less conditioned
It's
in the
right.
general speaking. You know, God is a very loaded.
Sorry.
Excuse me.
I'm sorry, I
Yeah.
didn't get the last thing.
All right. I think that I used the word God, but I think the friend you will never be able to see is a more open position, and it helps to be wondering about that, because that's really a curiosity and a kind of a transcendental effect on
transcends the mind very quickly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Very good. Thank you, Stefan.
Thank you.
And we have a question from Marjorie.
Okay.
Does the negative ego serve any purpose, even if it's not real? Do you have any experience with or desire to establish a working, loving relationship with the negative ego? It is possible to...
I prefer to have no relationship to it. On a good day, Marjorie, I have no relationship to it. On a bad day, I have a relationship to it. So the negative ego in this context is a source of pain and suffering, yourself and other. So the less of a relationship we have with it, the better.
Well, I guess that answers my question. I was wondering if you had any experience with the notion of trying to integrate those two, the negative and positive aspects of ego.
Well, I have always been suspicious of this word integration in this context. I think that the more we make the shift from negative ego to positive ego, and from positive ego to true self, authentic self, the better things get. The less you relate to your negative ego, the happier you're going to be, the kinder you're going to be, the more you're going to be just more generous, more kind, more trustworthy, more loving, more positive. Because the negative ego always has, the negative ego is like a, if you imagine a criminal, some terrible criminal, let's say a mafia boss has a very tough lawyer, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm using kind of a metaphor. So a mafia boss has this tough, very pushy lawyer who's very aggressive. So that's what the negative ego is like. They're very pushy, arrogant, aggressive, angry, victimized, self-righteous presence in our souls. And I think that in my way of thinking about the human condition and my way of teaching, the less room we give that lawyer to impose his will on us in any way, the happier we're going to be.
Well, that certainly makes sense, especially if we are saying that it's not real.
Well, remember in the Enlightenment Dharma, there's relative reality and absolute reality. So the negative ego is relatively real. And because it's relatively real, it can create karma. So we have to be careful with it.
Mm-hmm.
But so I'm not into this. I know a lot of people who do spiritual psychology are into integrating the negative, the shadow parts of our psyches. Mm-hmm. But I understand the theory, but I don't agree with the practice.
Okay, that makes sense from that perspective to me, because
it's very straightforward.
Yes, exactly.
It's called don't be a jerk.
Thank you.
It means don't be a jerk. Don't be arrogant. Don't be a wise guy. Don't be aggressive. Don't be paranoid. Don't be suspicious. Don't be mean spirited. Don't be unkind. Don't be a jerk.
Yeah, that's pretty much like the golden rule.
Yeah, exactly. So the point is that's why we want to, as we evolve spiritually, we want to have less and less to do with the negative ego. So the journey in evolutionary enlightenment is going from negative ego to positive ego, from positive ego to true self and authentic self. And even if our negative ego is active, this is part of my teaching, is even if the negative ego is active, we don't want other people to know it. So you would want to have, in the way that I teach, you'd want to be self-aware enough and have enough control over yourself that even if your negative ego is walking around the room inside yourself, creating disturbances for you, and no one else needs to know about it, no one else should feel you becoming weak and becoming victimized and becoming angry or frightened. No one needs to know. If you get utterly desperate, utterly desperate, utterly desperate, if you become utterly desperate and you need to ask for help. But if you're practicing at a high level, you know, you don't need, no one needs to know that you're struggling with the inner demon. Because if you start talking about these demons, they start becoming more real. Which is better, we don't talk, if we see them, we take responsibility for them, and we can disidentify with them. But if we get so desperate that we have to start talking about them, we should, so we don't drown. But I'm just saying that when we start speaking about these things, we give them more reality, and that's very dangerous. This is why Marjorie, in this teaching, I always talk about learning to have no relationship with these negative parts of ourselves. Learn how to cultivate the capacity to have no relationship with these negative parts of ourselves. And if I say no relationship, I'm not saying you're not denying anything, you're not avoiding anything, you're not repressing anything, you're not doing any kind of spiritual bypassing. You are choosing, you're consciously choosing to have no relationship with negative karmic momentum. And if you choose to have no relationship with negative karmic momentum, you won't act out of it. And if you won't act out of it, you won't create more negative karmic momentum. That's all good. But you have to be strong, you have to be strong, you have to be spiritually strong, spiritually committed.
Thank you, Andrew.
Am I making sense?
Yes, I
See, this is not a psychological remedy. I'm like, this is a spiritual remedy.
Yes, I am familiar with that. I've studied the work of Ernest Holmes from Science of Mind, and he speaks a lot about the denial of evil, I guess is what he calls. I don't even think he even uses the word evil. But I think what I'm hearing is that you're speaking from that same mindset.
Same vantage point.
Yes, I think so. Yeah. Which makes sense to me. But it's not easy, like you said.
It's not easy because you're giving the ego no room. Mm-hmm. That's why it seems harder. It seems harder because we're not giving the ego any room to breathe. Mm. That's why it's radical.
Yes.
Good
it
March.
Does not. Thank
sorry,
you.
Sorry. We'll finish what you were saying. Sorry.
I think it does not fit in well with the modern psychology.
Oh no, it's terrible. It doesn't make it fit at all. We live in a victim culture now, no?
Yes. It seems that way, doesn't it? Well, thank you, Andrew. I don't want to take up too much more time if there's others that want to speak.
Yeah, that's fine. But it is that way, Marvin. It's a victim culture. So it makes all of this kind of unwholesome behavior seem reasonable. Anybody else have any more questions?
We don't have more questions.
Let's give everybody another minute or two to see if they do have any more questions. Because if you do have questions, you should ask them. We don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. So it's good to, if you have any questions, you should ask them. Karma, Dharma, Destiny, and Free Will. I like the title. Karma, Dharma, Destiny, and Free Will. Sandy, how are we doing? Have we got up to an 8 yet, or are we still at 7? Can't hear.
I was just in the process of typing another question, actually.
You can ask a question.
Do you have any resources that you would recommend for someone starting out with this, trying to understand better the enlightenment process? I don't know. Anything?
Well, I've written a few books. One book's called Evolutionary Enlightenment, which is a very good book. And if you're finding this compelling, I lead meditations on every Saturday. Where do you live?
East Coast.
I get do meditations every Saturday, and every 2 weeks I give these talks.
Okay, I think a meditation would be a great idea.
It's very good. I take people through very simple instructions. I teach people how to let go of the mind. And it's a beautiful teaching.
Saturday, got it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anything else before we finish, everybody? All right, thank you.